Grace, peace, and mercy to you in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, our Savior, and our friend. Amen. So Scripture describes God and God's relationship to God's people. People. Maybe you didn't hear me. People. Human beings in all our messiness. People. Human beings. Just like you and me. Sometimes we forget that. Sometimes we forget that the Bible reports fallible people being loved by a persistent God. We so easily miss the humanness of things. These people working out God's desire that we might be one as the Father and the Son are one. Working out the Spirit's holy calling to love one another. Working out the strange reality of belonging to God, belonging to God, and also being in the world. I imagine that many of the experiences of the early church feel a lot more like the experiences of the present church than we would like to allow. Let us pray. Lord God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. Lord God, may the preacher decrease that you might increase. Amen. I imagine that part of the reason we separate out and sacralize the experiences of the early church is because we want to distance them from our own lives. Because it would be easier than hearing how those experiences might hit home, might tickle our ears, echo and mirror our own realities today. Imagine, for example, what Peter is going through in these chunks of the first chapter of Acts. Imagine what those 120 people are saying to poor Peter. Pastor Peter, Pastor Peter, we feel so betrayed by Judas. We thought he was one of us. We thought he would lead us with the 11. Pastor Peter, Pastor Peter, Jesus has ascended and has promised the Holy Spirit to us. What now? What do we do in the meantime? Is it even the meantime, or is it happening now and we just don't get it? We can't discern that. How will we know that the Spirit is active? Why do we keep waiting and we keep praying? We need to do something. Pastor Peter, Pastor Peter, Judas is dead. I mean, you know, we didn't particularly like the fella, but he's dead. Look at that empty seat, that hole where he used to be. We're not whole anymore without him. Do something, Peter. Pastor Peter, Pastor Peter, the empty spot is killing us. It feels like everything is unraveling. How can we continue? Will there even be a church in a few years? Poor, poor Peter. He does what he can. Everyone prays together. They scour the scriptures until they shine. And then, in his coffee-induced delirium, he lifts up a chunk of Psalm 69 and another chunk of Psalm 108. The first is about the guilty being disinherited, and the second is about appointing a new person to take the position of the guilty. And he lifts up these two chunks of scripture and says, "Aha! Poor Peter. He has decided we need to replace Judas, so there will be 12 again." So he recommends to these 120 people gathered together that they do just that. And they go for it. After all, what do they have to lose at this point? At least Peter is doing something. Despite there being both men and women who followed Jesus, who witnessed the resurrection at this gathering. In fact, the first witness to the resurrection, Mary Magdalene. In fact, Jesus' own mother. Both are present there at this assembly of people. But Peter grabs two men and he says, "Let's choose one of these to replace Judas. Let's cast lots." And they do. And guess what? We never again hear from either of those two men, Justus or Mattathias. Instead, they fade away in Scripture. So instead of following the path of Peter, the Holy Spirit does something else. Instead, the Spirit follows the way of God. The Spirit comes and shakes everything up. Greeks, eunuchs, sorcerers, women, all are moved into the community, moved to preach the gospel, moved to become like the 12. And more amazing still, a great persecutor of the church, one as bad and as dishonorable and as deplorable as Judas, shows up. Paul fills the empty space of Judas, the empty space needing to be filled because of Judas's betrayal and Judas's death. Paul, of all people, so strange. Paul is grafted into this league of apostles. He is a wild branch grafted onto a tame tree. And he weighs so heavily that he splits this tree open, creating a branch so wide and green that no one knows what to do with it. And of course, it's not his doing, it's the Spirit's. But he doesn't know what to do with this. No one does, even the Apostle Paul. I would venture to suggest that's why the Apostle Paul writes so much. He's trying to figure out what he's gotten himself into, what the Spirit is doing with him despite his own limited nature, his own badness and humanness. So that's what ends up happening with this thing that Peter plans. It doesn't go like you would think. The Spirit takes another path that includes this strange man, Paul. And my imagination tells me that Peter, in those quiet moments at night, unable to get to sleep, he would perhaps ask himself, "Gee, how did we get here? What's God up to? How have we got through all this despite God acting in places and ways and with people who the 12 apostles found impossible?" And I imagine, too, he might, on one of those tired and questioning and contemplative nights, have an aha moment, find the answer that he should have already known, and yet it was hidden to him. And he says, when he has this realization, "Oh my, did I not eat with Jesus? And after that supper, did not Jesus pray for us? Did Jesus not pray that the invisible God, the great I am, be made known in him and him in us? Did Jesus not pray that Jesus protected us with a fierce motherly love despite being opposed by the world? Did Jesus not pray that we would testify to God's goodness found in Christ? That some would be set aside and sent out to be little Christs in the world for the sake of the world? I suppose," he would finish to himself on those long, contemplative, anxious nights, "I suppose Jesus prayed for us, and Jesus' prayers for his people are continually answered. Not as we, the people, might wish or expect, but as the Holy Spirit wills." And here today, y'all say things like, "Pastor, look at the empty seat where my friend once sat. And even my own grandchild has abandoned the church. This is a betrayal. Where our bishop sees the present church as being in the midst of a great unraveling. The yarn is being lovingly collected as it unwinds and preserved, that it might be reused and made into something new and grand, the nature of which we do not yet know. And yet, like Paul, when we reach that goal, we'll say, 'Aha! Of course.' Where our neighbors and the closest partners in ministry we have, Cross of Life down the street in Plainfield, has voted to close its doors. Where church attendance in the last decade has fallen by 19%, and yet average giving has raised up by 14%. Where the ELCA in a two-day period has made history by electing our first, followed by our second, female African descent bishops, first in Philly and then in Madison, Wisconsin. Here today, with both peril and promise balanced upon a needle point. All these things, the chances we have today, so filled with loss and also so filled with gain that we can hardly understand what God is doing. Here today, like Peter and his crew, like the early church, we act, we pray, we dive into Scripture, and we do the work of the church as we most faithfully know how, making our educated best guesses, our faithful best guesses, not knowing the end of what we do. But we also trust. We trust that Jesus prayed for us. We know not how or where the Spirit shall move, but she shall move. Jesus prayed for us, and surely his prayers shall not fall upon deaf ears. Jesus prayed for us. Unity, witness, sanctity, the great revealing of the I Am's love for us and our participation in that love. Jesus prayed for us. Amen and hallelujah.